Well, welcome everyone. Welcome to the Wolf Lecture. So I am not Wolf, I'm Ross, Caroline Ross. This is Wolf, John Wolf. He was the originator of 3091. And this lecture is in his honor. And the idea of this lecture is to spread the joy about material science and engineering and hopefully educate people and inspire people and show everyone what a cool topic material science and engineering is. So John Wolf was a very dynamic lecturer. This is him waving his arms around. You can see in the background there's a micrograph of some grain structure. In fact, Chem can probably tell us what that looks like. Looks like a metal. And he's talking about solidification. So we want to engage the imagination of particularly freshmen and inspire you to become material scientists just like John Wolf was. So having said that, let me hand over to this year's, there we go. This semester's Wolf Lecturer. This is Professor Chem Tassan from our own department. And Chem came to us having worked at the Max Planck Institute in Germany. And before that, he was did a PhD in Eindhoven, and he has his undergrad degree from Middle East Technical University in Ankara in Turkey. So he's moved around a lot, and now he's settled here, much to our satisfaction. So Chem's done some really inspiring work, in particular looking at things like how materials deform and change in a microscope so you can see things going on. Famously, the action of a razor blade in cutting hair can be visualized in real time. So that's just one example, and hopefully we'll hear a lot more exciting examples. So let me hand over to Chem Tassan.
Well, thanks everybody. First of all, can you guys hear me? Can everybody hear me in the back? Perfect. And thanks, Caroline, for this very exciting introduction. Come on in, guys. You can sit just in front of me here if you want. Well, that's the pay. That's the penalty to pay, right? All right. So I'm going to be talking about hydrogen, and I'm going to be complaining a little bit about hydrogen, as you can see from the title here. But before I start, I need to acknowledge these wonderful researchers that have carried out the research here. In particular order, but alphabetic, Dylan, Felicity, Haushe, Jinwoo, Quinkshik, Maria, Muhadese, and many other collaborators have contributed to this work, and I would like to acknowledge that before I start. Well, as Caroline mentioned, well, they are sisters, so. as she mentioned, describing material science can be complicated, right? So before this talk, I was thinking, okay, I need to convince some freshmen to, you know, declare course 3 as their major, so what can I say? So I thought about, you know, the typical material science-y sentences here. Sort of, we are builders of, you know, solid matter using a medium of atoms. Sounds very cool. And I think for many freshmen, this sounds more like, you know, you get the you know, the periodic table, you take a blender of some sort, and then you sort of throw that in and you get some materials. Like in my case, you get some alloys, right? You put iron and you sort of randomly get some alloying elements there. Or you get nickel and you add some alloying elements there to make it nicer. Another cool sentence of the same kind is, you know, we rely on structure property relationships. This is also very, very common that we use as we define our field, right? And now when you talk about structure, though, it's kind of complicated. It really depends on the scale that you are talking about. You know, what do we actually mean by structure? And get ready, now I'm going to make you all drunk for 10 seconds. Now, if you take a look at this bolt, and if you zoom in and in and in and in, you see more and more details. Wait for 3 times, and then you are drunk, basically. So as you watch this, you see a surface, then you zoom in, then you see grains, then you see defects, and you see atoms at different scales. And as material scientists, this is really the journey that we are doing all the time. We make this journey, and we try to understand what's happening across these scales. Now, if you're all drunk, then I can go, you know, more happy with my presentation. So these are all those different scales. And I was thinking about this journey, this voyage, that reminded me another thing from my childhood. So now, when I sit with my daughter, we often play, you know, PlayStation 4 every now and then, and one of our favorite games is It Takes Two. So these beautiful graphics, and you know, you just go and kill bees and things. It's kind of fun stuff. But when I was a child myself, my computer was this thing. This is an Amstrad. Does anybody here know Amstrad? Let me see hands. Oh, not so bad, so 5% or something. So this game I used to play, so we wouldn't do any internships or things in summer. We would just go and play computer games and then sucker, and then it would be the next day, and then we would repeat it. That was not so bad. So this computer that I had only green screen, so it's different shades of green, one of my favorite games was this game called Fantastic Voyage. I didn't know then. It turns out that it's an Asimov book. The game here is about a character that goes into a miniaturized spaceship, or a ship rather, and then he's thrown into the human body to go and find bacteria and kill them. And you see some scenes from it. You start from the mouth, and then you sort of go into the throat and die there or something. So I spend my summers playing this. And actually, that reminded me, basically, that this journey here is a fantastic journey of its own. And today, I plan to take you on this journey, basically. And if you look carefully, I'm leading the journey, so you have to follow me. So, but why hydrogen? Well, hydrogen is up there on the upper left. That basically means it's very, very light, and it's pretty small. And that basically means that across all of these scales, he comes in and does some mischievous things and annoys us, basically. So we have to really take into account what's going on at different scales when we are talking about hydrogen. So that's the sort of scientific motivation. But on the other hand, we would also have, as this is an engineering department, we also have an engineering motivation. So, well, hydrogen goes into metals and it makes them brittle. So you take a material that should sustain the loads that the component is designed for. Well, in this case, if there is hydrogen around, it doesn't. There is catastrophic failure. Well, the other possibility, well, the other news that you see hydrogen, hear about hydrogen pretty often these days, well, we have a beautiful seat for you right in front of me here, is because it may be the solution to our problems. Nice. It may be the solution to our energy problem. So not only it's a problem because it's an embrittler, a very effective embrittler, but at the same time, it can be a solution. So it's an engineering problem that we have to deal with. Now, throughout this presentation, we are going to have this journey across different scales, and I'm going to have three themes. First, we'll talk about hydrogen and dislocations. That's going to be at this scale. And then we'll travel here. At this scale, we'll talk about hydrogen and new phases. And then we'll travel a bit more to larger scales, and then we'll talk about hydrogen and surfaces. OK? All right, let's go. So hydrogen and dislocation. So the typical thing we do in my lab is we take a machine, we put it in a scanning electron microscope, and we do in situ experiments. So most of the stuff that you will see will have some connection to in situ characterization here. And when we talk about dislocations, it's difficult not to mention a part of MIT history here. So those of you who've taken mechanics of materials or physical metallurgy have seen Orovan looping. And that's an actual person. So Orovan was a Hungarian scientist who moved to Germany and then eventually moved to MIT, actually, here. And what's cool about Orovan is that he has these papers in German that's written up introducing dislocations before any transmission electron microscopy technique-based proof was there. So this is really impressive stuff if you think about it, if you think about the fact that more or less all metal forming industry is based on a knowledge of this kind. Now, that's Orovan. Well, Orovan's PhD student is somebody you might know. That's Ali Argon, who was a professor here in the mechanical engineering department and a legend. And when I was a student, when I was an undergrad, I would look at him and I would think, man, this, how can they be so good, these professors? And Ali Argon's PhD student is Teresa Pollock. And Teresa Pollock was here only this week. So this is a quick show to you that how we are a part of history. So if you go back just two generations, we don't know anything about dislocations. And now two generations afterwards, you know, we have all PhD theses, all this knowledge, all these industries based on this knowledge. It's pretty impressive. All right, back to material science. So now we are looking at a BCC metal. So this is an iron-based alloy. It's a stainless steel, in fact. It's BCC, so we are going to talk about structure, right? So we are going to do an in situ experiment where we will charge hydrogen to the sample. Kwingshik Kim is doing this experiment. I promise you fun videos, and we have an awful start here. This is the least fun video that you've ever seen in your lives. So Quinkshank came to me, so there's actually a video, you see time is evolving. He came to me and he said, I'm so depressed, you know, I see nothing in these experiments. So we turned off the lights and we had this romantic 10 minutes looking at the screen. Then I think I saw something. And when you look closer, actually, you do see some things moving here. So that's a dislocation moving as we charge hydrogen in the SEM to this sample. And then we started looking further. We found other friends that move around and further and other guys. And then when we zoom out, it turns out that many of these guys are moving. So what does this mean? We are charging hydrogen. Remember, hydrogen is in the upper left corner of the periodic table. This is a tiny guy that we charge, and it goes into solid solution, yet it's moving these line defects around. Now let's put some numbers there. So this is BCC, total glide distance. So only 5% or so of these dislocations are moving. Many of them don't move, which will be an important point, so remember that. But look at the distances that move here around, so less than a micron or so. So dislocation is a line defect, atomic scale defect, right? So now we are talking about a micron or up to a micron move just by charging the hydrogen. So there is no stress here. There is no heating, nothing. All we do is have dislocation go through these hydrogen go through these crystal structures, and we see dislocations moving. Now, there are a couple of other things. One of them is that the major activity is at the initial stages of the interaction. So dislocations initially move, then they don't move. And second, if you look at the activity as a function of the distance to grain boundaries around, you don't see any dependence. So you can be very near a grain boundary. You can be very far away from a grain boundary as a dislocation. It doesn't seem to have any influence. Again, keep this in mind. So then we do some simulations. So this is with Zhu Li's group, MD simulations. So now hydrogen, this is a dislocation here. So this is a flux of hydrogen going from left to right. The question is, are these dislocations going to move? And as you can see, I'll run this one once again. So it starts here and the dislocation moves all the way there. And then it stops, just like we've seen in the experiments. So it's running again now. So as the hydrogen flux goes in this direction, dislocation moves. And as it gets decorated, as you start seeing more and more of these red dots, hydrogen atoms, it's pinning the dislocation so that it doesn't move anymore. Now you see the snapshots. We started there. And as you see, we moved a little bit. And this initial motion and then stop can also be seen in this plot here. Now, what does this mean? So hydrogen moves without an external stress, as we dislocations move without an external stress as we charge hydrogen. That's one observation. Two, major activities at the initial stages of the interaction, then no activity, and activity not linked to grain boundaries. Now, these simulations give us insights about where this is coming from. Well, it moves, it turns out, due to the attractive interaction between the hydrogen flux, this flux that is moving, and the dislocation core. Well, after a while, there's no motion because actually many of these hydrogen atoms, they get trapped at the core of the dislocation. So they are pinning the dislocation after a while. And finally, not linking to grain boundary must be linked to the high diffusivity of BCC. So in BCC crystal structures, diffusivity is very high. So you don't need to, a hydrogen atom doesn't need to go to a boundary. It can just go through the bulk and it will be fine. So that was BCC. Now, let's do an experiment. Let's put more alloying elements, more elements into our blender and mix it a little bit so that we get an FCC. It's not too complicated. You just increase the amount of manganese and reduce other things. So now we have a BCC, FCC alloy here. And you are now looking at the most amazing experiment that I've ever seen get out of my lab. So what you see here are dislocations just dancing around as we just charge hydrogen in this FCC, material. There is nothing going on. The sample is sitting on a stub. In this case, actually, hydrogen is coming out, but it doesn't really matter. And the dislocations are dancing all around. Now, you can increase the number of such movies. Here is a pileup. This is a boundary here, and you see a piled up dislocation or a dislocation array that is piled up, and you see them moving as hydrogen comes out. Here's another example, as you know, again, hydrogen coming out and dislocations moving around. So why do I say that this is a very impressive thing? Now look at the scales involved with this. So now this was BCC. Remember, we were up to a micron. Here in FCC, first of all, almost all of the dislocations are moving as we charge hydrogen or as hydrogen goes out. And the distances almost reach out to 2 microns or so. Now, sometimes these numbers don't mean much. So I'll give you a little thought experiment here. So imagine that the door opens now and we have five people coming in. And those five people come and sit right in between these guys here to create a dislocation. Right? So now there's some compressive stress here. People are a little bit unhappy. Maybe police presence is possible. So those guys are sitting there, right? So now we have created a dislocation. And now imagine that the door opens again. We have now five elementary school kids come to the room. They don't even go to the dislocation yet. They just come to the boundary. And imagine this pathway is the boundary here. And as that happens, that dislocation jumps to mass Ave. That's what's happening here. So the scales are crazy. Scales are crazy here. So we should understand it. Why don't we do more molecular dynamic simulations? So now atomistic simulations again. Now it's a little bit different. It's FCC. So we are taking nickel as an example. So first thing, so these are simulations from a postdoc, Muhadese. So Muhadese ran these simulations. And first thing she saw, now hydrogen is red in this case, that hydrogen goes to the boundaries rather than the dislocations. It goes to the surface. It goes to the boundaries. And actually, that's a big difference. If the hydrogen is at the boundaries but not in the bulk, that essentially means how can it interact with dislocations the same way we saw these interactions in BCC, this flux-type interactions. So the other thing she's seen is that as we reduce the hydrogen chemical potential, so as hydrogen goes out in a way, we see these dislocations are moving again. So in the, when we repeat the simulations the same way we do the experiments, we see the dislocations moving again. So they were at the boundaries. As they get out of the boundaries, we see the dislocations moving. And here are some snapshots if you have trouble seeing this. So without hydrogen, if you look at three dislocations here, really not much action as you wait. And with hydrogen coming out, you see these dislocations moving, new dislocations are generated, and so forth. So in summary, no dislocation activity in presence of, no dislocation activity in absence of hydrogen, but plenty of it in presence of hydrogen, but a very different type. This is because of segregation at the boundaries. Now it turns out that you can also quantify some of the forces, stresses associated with this. So if hydrogen goes to the boundaries, then segregates to those boundaries, this creates some stress here, right? It's really like putting a lot of people at this boundary here, at this pathway here, and that's causing stresses that are long range or longer range. And it turns out, based on her simulations, that these stresses can reach hundreds of megapascals, which is an important detail. If the stresses are not high enough, then you wouldn't see dislocation motion. So this is pretty amazing. So hydrogen segregation in this case is leading to stresses. But the important point is this thing that is happening is going to be different at different points. So if I zoom in here, I see it. If I zoom in somewhere else, I won't see it because it depends on the level of the segregation that's taking place. So we are playing in this ground here, in this playground here at these scales, and we see already pretty annoying things. So if you look at hydrogen and dislocations, first of all, hydrogen alone can cause dislocations to move in BCC metals. But hydrogen can also cause the opposite in BCC metals, so pin the dislocations, literally just the opposite observation. And then for FCC, hydrogen can cause dislocation motion through a totally different mechanism, not through flux and interaction of the flux with the dislocation core, but rather segregating at the boundaries and stresses associated with it. But hydrogen can also not cause these effects unless, you know, if there is no segregation taking place at the boundaries. So if you were wondering where this title is coming from, I think the theme should be getting a bit clearer here. So I sit in my office and student after student comes with these conflicting results, and this is what I keep on telling myself. All right, so that was FCC, remember, but we can put in our blender a number of different things. So maybe I can put a little bit more manganese and play with the stacking fault energy of the material. So if I do this, so now it looks a little bit different here, but it's still the same crystal structure, right? So atoms still go to the same places. It's mostly iron again, but just the alloying elements are different. We've just made a different cocktail here. Now I'm going to show you a different type of map. This is coming from EBSD, and it's colorful because it's showing different phases. So the green phase here actually is the FCC phase. And all that's going to happen in a moment is what happens when we charge hydrogen. Remember, previously we charged hydrogen and we've seen dislocations move. And remember, the scales there were hundreds of nanometers and micron or so. And look at the scale here, first of all. We are now looking at a 100 micron scale. And we charge hydrogen, and this happens. and then we charge more hydrogen, and then that happens. So let me go back and forth again here. So what is going on here? These are clearly not dislocations in this case. Well, what's happening in this case is a phase transformation. So it's still FCC, so hydrogen, I assume it will still go and diffuse through the boundaries. But in this case, instead of just causing dislocations to move, the stresses are high enough and the stacking fault energy is suitable enough that we actually have a phase transformation going on. We have a crystal structure change going on just due to the fact that you charge hydrogen. Again, the sample is literally just sitting on an electrolyte and we just put hydrogen in. There's no pulling, no heating, no cooling, and you just change the crystal structure by this. Pretty amazing. Now, this is an example of how hydrogen can cause phase transitions, but the most common, the most well-known example of this are with materials that are hydride formers. So now we'll jump into a world of, now we are at this scale in our spacecraft, in our fantastic voyage, and now we are going to look at titanium alloys. So titanium alloys, if you are into titanium, the most common titanium alloy that you will see is Ti64, titanium 6, aluminum 4, vanadium, most commonly used alloy. And this is how its microstructure looks. Now it's HCP plus BCC, so we have two crystal structures here because it's a multi-phase alloy. Now if you go and charge hydrogen to titanium, now we are going to use actually two techniques, not only in-situ SEM charging, but also charging in a synchrotron facility because we want to learn more about the new phase that's forming, and for those kind of activities, for those kind of insights, diffraction is a very useful technique. So now this is a movie of us charging hydrogen to titanium, Ti64, from the backside, and we are looking from the top side. Now it's a 5-micron view field here, and I'll go back and forth so that you see what's happening here. So these are the two phases, and what's happening is as time goes forward, you see this new phase slowly appearing at the phase boundary between alpha titanium and beta titanium, and that's the hydride that's forming. Now, if you look at the snapshots, it looks like this. At different times, we see the hydride getting thicker and thicker. And you might say, how do you know that this is hydride? Well, you can go and do diffraction. In this case, you can go and do electron backscatter diffraction, EBSD, to index this to be a hydride phase. So you might say, well, OK, in this case, hydrogen seems to be behaving pretty nicely. So why are you complaining about it in this case? Well, it's not really behaving so nicely. So here's an example of how hydride formation depends on phase morphology. So if I'm making these titanium alloys, by changing the thermal treatment that I make, I can change the morphology of the phases. I can make it equiax or I can make it lamellar, for instance. And it turns out that if I have equiax versus lamellar, the type of hydrides that will form is going to be different. That's not all. Hydride formation also depends on grain size or microstructure size in general. So if I, instead of having this scale of the alpha plus beta type of microstructure, if I refine my microstructure to be this size. So now look at the micron bars here. This is 2 microns, this is 10 microns, so it's more or less in the same scale, but the grain size and the phase size here is much, much finer. In this case, in the upper case, with a coarse microstructure, we see more or less every boundary showing hydride formation. Whereas when you refine the microstructure so much, to our surprise, we start seeing that hydride formation, nucleation, and growth processes take in very specific locations in the microstructure, and growth takes place afterwards from those points. And third, hydride formation seems to also depend on the local defect density, dislocation density, and distribution. So maybe you can see it here, although it's not so easy to see. So this is a beta phase here, and what this map is showing is the density of geometrically necessary dislocation. So it's the density of the defects we talked about at the beginning. And at the boundary here, there is higher density of GNDs, whereas here it's a bit lower. And as you charge hydrogen and form the hydride, you typically see that hydride nucleation is going to take place where you have more accommodation dislocation. So what that essentially means is that if I have a microstructure and if I have more defects in some around the boundary, and if I charge hydrogen, hydride formation seems to, in these materials, it seems to take place more preferentially at those high defect density zones, which is also statistically shown. So I said three dependencies: morphology dependency, size dependency, and defect density dependency. We have, as material scientists, knobs, remember, to play with these if we want to optimize things. But as the dependencies get more and more complicated, obviously it becomes difficult to know how to play with these knobs. Now, these in situ experiments also give us insights about where these dependencies are coming from. So for instance, here you see results from in situ synchrotron diffraction experiments. And what this essentially shows is that the beta peak, so beta was one of the phases in this alloy, the beta peak is not only broadening, but it's also shifting as we charge hydrogen. That's the only thing we are doing. We are just charging hydrogen, and we see a change in the diffraction peak. And that essentially means that we have strains in the beta phase, so microstrains. So as hydrogen tries to diffuse through this boundary, diffuse through this hallway, it's causing, again, stresses around. And those stresses play a key role in what's happening next. You can also see this with in situ SEM experiments again. Now, if you look at the geometrically necessary dislocations before charging and after charging, so blue is before, red is after, you basically see these densities go up. So as you charge hydrogen, you have to have more dislocations to accommodate for the volume increase. So as you form anhydride, the volume increases, so the microstructure around it needs to accommodate this volume increase. So summary here is that hydrogen diffuses preferentially through the beta phase and causes actually an expansion of this beta phase. And this expansion often needs to be accommodated by forming new defects. Remember, we were talking about defects at the beginning. We were charging hydrogen and we were seeing defects moving around. In this case, actually, we are creating defects just because of the fact that there's volume increase associated with the new phase that forms due to the hydrogen. So now our spaceship is at this scale, right? We are looking at all of these different new phases that can form. And what did we learn from here? So what we learn is hydrogen forms hydrides in titanium alloys. Well, this is well known, obviously. But then there's much more we can learn from these in situ experiments. This hydride formation depends on microstructure morphology, it depends on grain size, it depends on dislocation density, and many other factors of this kind. So again, I'm sitting in my office, sending students away, and thinking to myself, come on, hydrogen, be nice for once. And you see the number of exclamation marks are increasing here. So, so now let's be a little bit positive, because we are, after all, engineers, and we need to solve problems. And many of the problems, many of the solutions to hydrogen-related problems are actually at the surface. So we can do a lot at these scales, at much larger scales. We can do a lot also at these other scales. But that's topic of another talk, maybe. So we are looking, as engineers, we are looking for simple solutions, right? It needs to be feasible, it needs to be useful. Otherwise, there's no point in coming up with a solution. And we are looking for solutions because we are DMSE, after all. That E is for engineering. It's not just looking at dislocations. It's not just looking at, you know, cracks appearing. We also want to actually try to solve things. We want to engineer these problems. All right, there are many, many solutions that we and others think about when we consider hydrogen embrittlement. And I'm going to show you three today that is stemming from my group and groups we collaborate here, Ju Lee's group and Bilge Yildiz's group specifically. So this is a whole list of possible solutions, but we'll focus on three of them. The first one is a strange idea of taking a metal and making its surface rough so that you improve hydrogen embrittlement, resistance against hydrogen embrittlement. So this sounds, again, like a bad idea. Normally, we try to take metals and make them shiny so that we can look at ourselves and feel good. But in this case, you want to roughen it so that things will get better. The second one is a bit of a straightforward one, but I want to show to you that it's actually not as straightforward as one might think, which is basically putting a permeation barrier coating. So if I put a coating, if hydrogen is not going in, then maybe I can solve all of these problems I've mentioned at the beginning. And third is, again, a kind of a strange idea, but it's kind of straightforward, too. So if hydrogen is coming anyway, so maybe we can take it out. So if it's going inside, maybe we can also try to take it out. We can desorb it out by electrochemically assisting it. So this is an electrochemical desorption approach. All right, let's take a look at all three of them. The first one, I would have really liked to say that I was sitting in my office one day and I had this brilliant idea and it worked, but it's totally not like that in this case. So the student, in this case Dylan, was doing experiments and he came to my room with these results and we didn't believe these results for months. And it turns out that it's actually it's actually perfect. And the finding here that's interesting is that if you take the same alloy, it's the same Ti64 we talked about a moment ago, and if you polish it so it has a mirror-like finish, then you see strong hydrogen embrittlement. So this is a stress-strain curve, strain as a function of stress. The normal material behavior is like this. That's the uncharged case here. So when you polish the sample and then charge hydrogen, you see that the ductility is lost. Now the material fails only after a few percent. But you take the same material, instead of polishing it, you finish with a ground surface, a rough surface. You get more or less the same behavior as an uncharged material, even though you charge hydrogen to it. So this doesn't make sense, or didn't make sense for a while until we figured out where it's coming from. And I like this story a lot because it also shows the importance of science that's based on observation. You know, sometimes we can come up with hypotheses and design very nice research around it, and sometimes we just have to look at things and see new things and recognize that they are new and have a little bit of fun there. So in this case, it turns out that as you roughen the surface of a metal, in this case titanium, what you are doing is you are introducing a lot of defects just below the surface. Of course, this is well known. If you are doing plastic deformation on the surface, you are going to introduce a lot of defects there. Compared to the case, these are TEM lamellas, by the way, compared to the case where you have a polished sample, where there are no defects below. So defects or no defects, why would this matter? Well, it matters because once you start charging hydrogen, and now you are looking at nanosims measurements, basically, what you see is that if you have a high density of defects just below the surface, those defects play a very good role in actually keeping that hydrogen there. So I have a sample, it has a surface that's a little bit rough, so now there's hydrogen that's trying to go in. Remember, if it goes in, it's going to make this material brittle. But what ends up happening is that it's captured in this very thin surface layer because there's a high defect density there at the surface, which is also quantitatively shown here. So when you use secondary ion mass spectroscopy here, you can catch more hydrogen trapped in that surface layer compared to in the ground case compared to the polished case. So roughening leads to more hydrogen trapping near the surface. So if more hydrogen is trapped near the surface, less goes in. That's good news for us. But that's not all. Actually, in this case, Jinwoo Kim, who was a postdoc in my group, designed this beautiful experiment, in situ optical microscope experiment, where he's charging hydrogen to a sample and looking at the bubbles that appear from using an optical microscope. So you might say, why do we care about bubbles that appear? Well, because the bubbles that appear are showing us something about the hydrogen that recombines. So you are trying to charge hydrogen, but some of the hydrogen is actually going to recombine and go out as hydrogen gas. That's the hydrogen that doesn't go into the material. So maybe there's a difference in hydrogen recombination in these two cases, was the idea. So these are the results of those experiments. So the specimen is in the middle. In one case, it's ground. In the other case, it's polished. And to our surprise, again, we see much larger bubbles and much larger amount of bubbles as we charge hydrogen. Now, this is shown here quantitatively. So what does this mean? So if I start with a rough surface and versus a polished surface, and in both cases, I put them in the same electrochemical cell, I'm trying to charge hydrogen to them in the same condition. But in the case of the rough surface, actually we have more hydrogen recombination. So some of the hydrogen, instead of being adsorbed and going into the material, it actually recombines to form hydrogen gas and forms a bubble and goes out. It going out means it's not going in. That's good news for Ti64 here. So roughening not only introduces this deformation layer that traps hydrogen, but also it's actually causing more hydrogen recombination so that hydrogen doesn't go in. So in summary, this can be summarized in this cartoon here, flat surface versus rough surface. You use the same electrolyte, same conditions. Everything is the same except for the surface finish of this material. It's the same alloy. And what's basically happening is that this guy, the rough guy, has more dislocations to begin with. Remember the same dislocations we talked about? In this case, they are now trapping the hydrogen just below the surface. And in this case, also in the rough case, we also have more hydrogen gas forming through this recombination process compared to the polished case. So that's solution number one. All you do is just grind the surface. Isn't it pretty amazing? Compared to everything else you might think about doing, changing the alloy, putting a coating, and so forth. Okay, let's look at the solution of coatings, actually. So this sounds like a pretty straightforward solution. If I put a layer on top of my material, and this layer is a slow hydrogen diffuser, hydrogen won't go into my material, I won't have embrittlement, so we are all good. That's the idea. And this is a very good demonstration of this. This is, by the way, also collaboration with the group of Bilge Yıldız and Julie and their teams. So this is a very good demonstration of how these kind of coatings can be very useful. So basically what we are looking at here is hydrogen permeation. So this is hydrogen permeation current, and here is time. So you have a sample, and you are trying to have hydrogen go through the material, permeate through the material. So the quicker the hydrogen goes, the worse that coating material is. You want hydrogen to go slow through this permeation barrier, right? So you want this curve to be as long as possible there. So this is the uncoated ferritic stainless steel. So as you see there, after an hour, you have hydrogen permeating throughout a sample. If I remember here, yeah, this is 400 nanometer thick sample here. So it takes only 1 hour to have hydrogen go through if you don't put a coating. Now, any type of coating of alumina that you put, so aluminum oxide that you put, is going to get better. So it's alumina. These oxides are very slow diffusers. And there's a dependency on the technique you use, but it just gets better. So if this is the case, what's the problem? Well, the problem is the fact that alumina is an oxide, and oxides do break easily. And if you want to use a coating on an application where there are stresses, where there is wear and tear, or where there are thermal stresses and other conditions, this will likely lead to cracking. So if you have a crack in a coating, that essentially means that hydrogen can now penetrate or permeate through that crack. So the fact that you would have low permeability elsewhere doesn't really matter. You have a weak point in your coating. And that's what's basically shown here. So now this is a single layer alumina coating. Again, the thickness is around 500 nanometers in this case. And what's done in these images is that Jinwoo is deforming these coatings. These are very thin materials, so it's not so easy to deform them. He came up with a nice way to do this. So as he applies this deformation, the deformation levels are very, very low here, just a percent, right? So you are not deforming these guys much. But already you start seeing a lot of these crack-like things. Of course, you are looking at a thin film from top, so it's not so easy to understand what it is. But if you zoom in, you very clearly see that these are actually delamination points. So you put a coating that's perfect. It's a slow diffuser. But as you wait, if there are some stresses around, these are going to crack and delaminate. And that's going to be the site where hydrogen goes in. So we don't only need functional properties here, but we also need mechanical properties. We need a coating that can handle this kind of condition. So the idea was, instead of having a single layer of alumina, why don't we have a multi-layered nanostructured coating? So instead of alumina alone, you would have alumina, aluminum, alumina, aluminum, alumina, multi-layered coating. Now, this comes with a number of benefits. First of all, it's not so complicated to do. There are techniques that we can use that can be scaled up to create this kind of technology. Keep in mind, if we are not finding a technology that solves the problem, that's cost-effective, then it's not really useful in the end. So it needs to be cost effective. Putting aluminum layers there won't sacrifice anything about hydrogen permeation. Aluminum itself doesn't really show much hydrogen embrittlement, so that's not a problem. And having these multi-layers have multiple benefits from a mechanics perspective. So if you have cracks, these cracks can change their paths and reduce their stress fields and so forth. And this is one of the results that show that our idea actually in this case works. So this is the multi-layered coating, the same type of sort of permeation test. And now the red guy here was the single alumina coating that kind of nicely works, right? So I've shown you that if you would have a single alumina layer, this is a good permeation barrier. However, the bad news is that if you deform it only 0.5% deformation, that's tiny. What you see is that the permeation resistance goes significantly down, getting very close to the material that is uncoated. So this is what we were afraid of, basically. Now, if you have a multi-layered coating, though, this is not what you see. So even when you introduce larger amount of deformation, say double the amount of deformation to a percent, then even then your permeation resistance then is actually better. And this is not an optimized result here. So why is that the case? Well, this is how, this is how the single layer looks again. You see all these delamination points. Now, if you look at the quad layer, you still see some thin lines here. This is a top SEM view, so you are looking at a slightly deformed guy. And you can see actually more if you use different secondary electrons, or rather a different detector to catch the secondary electrons. But what's critical here is that if you look at the cross-section, those cracks that may appear in the multilayered case are always going to be deflected in the aluminum layer and rarely will go through the entire coating to be able to have this kind of hydrogen embrittlement problem. So our permeation behavior, even in the damage case, is better, and our overall mechanical performance is better when we go to these multilayered nanostructured coatings. So this is actually a technology that's at the moment, the lab scale demonstrations are complete, and it's actually, in this case, licensed. So there's a company that's trying to make some products out of this at the moment. Now, the third solution is an accelerated desorption idea, remember. So there will be those cases where it's going to be difficult to try to put a coating, or it's going to be difficult to change the material as a whole. So one idea could be maybe we can try to pump hydrogen out. You know, remember those, I always forget their name, these vacuum cleaners that walk around themselves in the house when you are in the movies. So it's, imagine a technology of this kind that sort of walks around in a pipeline and goes to critical locations and pumps hydrogen out along certain intervals. Now, the idea here is based on the idea that hydrogen embrittlement mainly takes place at critical zones in engineering components. If you have a pipeline or if you have another critical product, this kind of embrittlement is not going to take place through the entire cross-section or entire volume. It's actually going to take place at very critical locations, for example, at welding zones. So if that's the case, instead of waiting for that weld to crack, we can simply go there and pump the hydrogen out, maybe. So Kyung-Shik Kim and Jin-Woo was working on this project. And it's kind of funny because normally when we want to study hydrogen embrittlement, we have to pump hydrogen into a sample, right? So this we do typically with electrochemical cells. We electrochemically charge hydrogen. Well, in case of electrochemical desorption, it's really just, you know, turning the current around. You just have the current run the other way around after charging hydrogen to a sample. And the cool thing about this is that you don't have to do it only with a wet condition. You don't have to do it with a liquid electrolyte. You can also do this with a solid electrolyte. I mean, you can imagine that a liquid electrolyte would be complicated if you want to put it in contact with some sort of component. But if you have a solid electrolyte, you can pump more easily the hydrogen from a practical perspective. Now, these are the lab scale demonstrations. In this case, the solid electrolyte that is used is developed in Zhu Li's lab in this case. It's an acid and clay electrolyte. And the experiments are shown here. So we charge hydrogen to a sample. We take a sample and we deform it. Then we deform the same a different sample of the same material by hydrogen charging. So we see how much embrittlement there is there. And then we do the same experiment by first hydrogen charging and then trying to pump the hydrogen out of the material. So first, to show some microstructures, this is the as-received material, this is the surface, and this is the bulk of it. Now, if you charge hydrogen to this material, you start seeing cracks. That's the hydrogen embrittlement. And you see very big cracks near the surface because there's a lot of hydrogen near the surface. And you see smaller cracks in the bulk because there is less hydrogen there. Now, if you take the same material, charge hydrogen, now pump the hydrogen out in the way that I've just described, you get to this, basically. So this is electrochemically assisted desorption. After 5 hours now, the size of these cracks that you see at the surface is significantly diminished. And the size of the cracks that you see and the bulk of the material is also significantly diminished. But these are just micrographs. Of course, the properties tell a better story. So here, these plots actually show that this kind of technology does work. And what you have here is in the x-axis is recovery time. And in the y-axis is the fraction of the uniform elongation recovery. So basically, the idea here is you have the uncharged material that has like 100% of the performance of this material. And if you charge hydrogen, now you lose the performance. So now 100% of the performance is gone. You could leave that sample outside, so hydrogen just comes out autonomously. It would go out into the air, so that's what we call recovery in air. then yes, you get the properties back, but that happens after 25 hours. Right? You have to leave your sample outside and wait 25 hours for the material to get back to its original properties. Whereas if you are electrochemically pumping the hydrogen out, this becomes now much, much shorter. And again, this is a solution that's not optimized. This is a proof of principle experiment that sort of shows that this idea in general works. Now, that's for ductility, that's uniform elongation, and here is the same kind of data for strength, because you also want to make sure that by charging hydrogen, you don't lose strength of your material. And in this case, what you see is that as you pump the hydrogen out, the strength of the material is retrieved. The cool thing about this technology is that as you pump the hydrogen out, this is for a reminder for myself actually here, as you pump the hydrogen out, you can also store the hydrogen that you just pumped out. So if this is an application where keeping hydrogen content, hydrogen losses in mind, or minimize them rather, this technology can also achieve that. All right, so let's zoom out again. We were looking for simple solutions, simple feasible solutions, and we now talked about three. We can do surface roughening. In case of surface roughening, we trap hydrogen at the surface and we have more hydrogen recombination, so we avoid hydrogen embrittlement. We can put a permeation barrier coating, we can put a coating, but we need to be careful. If the coating is just an oxide, it's going to crack very easily. But putting a multi-layered coating actually makes the solution, provides a solution to this problem. And finally, for accelerating desorption, I've shown you that you can actually effectively pump hydrogen out to retrieve the properties of the material. So that sort of brings us to the end of this journey here. I promise you that this will be a journey, like a fantastic voyage across different scales. So we talked about hydrogen and dislocations, and there we said hydrogen can come in and move dislocations in different ways, depending on the crystal structure. If it's BCC, it's the flux of hydrogen that moves the dislocations, but small amounts. If it's FCC, it's hydrogen segregation at the boundaries and stresses associated with it that causes hydrogen to move around. Then we talked about hydrogen and new phases. I've shown you that if I just change the composition a little bit, I can, just by charging hydrogen, form a new phase. I can form the HCP phase. And in titanium, I can form hydrides. But the hydride formation is strongly dependent on the other knobs I play with. How I change my microstructure, its morphology, its grain size, and so forth. And finally, at the bigger scale, at the scale of surfaces, scale that we can actually see with our own eyes, I've shown you that you can come with pretty straightforward solutions, like roughening a surface or coming up with multi-layered coatings or ways to sort of vacuum the hydrogen out from critical locations in your sample. So that actually brings me to the end of my talk. So I want to thank again for all of these wonderful, wonderful researchers that have carried out this research, and I want to thank you all for your attention.
Well, thank you very much, Chen, for that fantastic voyage.